Hey everyone, and welcome to this episode of ChetChat, where we are going to talk about why is it important to fail. I know what happens when we normally fail. We feel terrible about ourselves. We're unable to pick ourselves up and believe that despite the failure, we can be this rocking success. So the guest on my show today is Ashish Jaiswal, who's a PhD from the University of Oxford and an associate fellow at the Oxford Center of Education Policy Studies. He's written a book called Fluid, where he argues that the people who've altered the course of the world are the ones who failed, the ones who faltered and altered. So let's hear from him how all of this is going to affect the future of our careers. And let's hear why it's important for us to fail. But before we introduce you to Ashish, press the subscribe button and the bell icon right next to it so you keep getting your notifications every time we go online. So let's quickly invite Ashish to join us on the show. So Ashish, welcome to ChetChat.
Thank you.
And congratulations on your book launch.
Thank you.
Okay, so in the book, Fluid, you talk about failure and you talk about how failure is an important early stepping stone for success. So tell us a little bit about that and how that could be relevant for the students watching the show.
So, you know, I think that there are two reasons why somebody fails. One is probably when you are not good enough.
Mm-hmm.
And the second one is when you are attempting something which you haven't attempted before.
Okay.
And I think that invariably, if you look, reflect, most of the time it is something to do with a new sort of ground which you're breaking.
Mm-hmm.
And when we realize that we are failing because we are trying to move ahead, then it gives us this perspective that it's not something which is my personal enemy.
Mm-hmm.
It is my friend. It is telling me that be a better version of yourself. In fact, most of the people who have done great things in the world have failed invariably and many times.
Yes, fantastic. And it's almost like you're saying that I should treat every one of these failures as a feedback loop that is telling me, hey, this is what you can change and then keep going.
Absolutely. If you look at any of the discoverers or inventors or explorers, they would have failed 100 times before they would have achieved something in the end.
Right.
And they have fascinating stories.
Of course. There's this commonly known story about Edison and the light bulb.
Yes, absolutely.
And how he kept trying hundreds of different
materials.
And apparently tungsten was a material he had tried and failed. But because he had learnings from the failures of some of the other materials, he was able to suitably modify the final sort of one. And get it right. And to most others, it seemed like he just invented the light bulb, like one fine day, woke up and invented the light bulb.
And you know, that also sometimes scares us on personal level to invent or to discover.
Right.
Which is the rock bed of success. You know, because we have so much of stigma attached to this word.
Mm-hmm.
And right from our school times, and in fact, right at that time, it is pierced into our ears that, you know, you cannot fail.
Mm.
Or you are somehow inferior if you don't get that kind of marks.
Mm.
And I think it probably all starts from there, that, you know, I can't afford to fail.
So Ashish, in your book, you talk about Steve Jobs and how he grew up in California in this sort of techie, overwhelming environment. And yet, you talk about how it was the liberal arts college education that he had. That was a turning point for him that made him what he was. In India, somehow, I find that we tend to classify students as either bright, which means only math and engineering kind of, you know, capabilities, or creative, and then they do arts, etc. And we somehow, the cross-functional synergy, the idea that, you know, we can do both and a little bit of this and that at different points of time, it's not something which is part of our system.
True.
So what are your thoughts on this?
Yeah. First on Steve Jobs, I think when the first ever Mac was being designed, he was sitting in a garage wearing traditional Indian clothing with his head shaven, and listening to South Indian music on a loop.
Mm-hmm.
and learning minimalism from one aspect of life. You know, there is a difference between professional being and human being. A professional being is taught in a manner that, you know, this is your daira, this is your box, and you do not require to actually integrate. Even if you're doing liberal arts, somehow you're taught that, you know, science is a bad word, or this is not the group you hang out with. Like in one of the interviews, Sundar Pichai was asked that, you know, and in fact, it's one of his famous talks, he said that, you know, go beyond your books, you know, try to look into alternative thoughts. Tim Cook recently came to Oxford and gave a talk, and I found that, you know, he's sounding so similar to the idea of fluid or breaking the boundaries of arts and science. Engaging with the other side makes you that human being.
Right.
And I you know, I think that, you know, when we look at these people who have done sort of some advancement in their own field, you realize that the magic happens at the cusp of discipline.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. In fact, this is a famous statement made by Tom Kelly,
yes,
the partner at IDEO, absolutely, who says that you can never be the best engineer, but when engineering meets anthropology, that's when the magic will happen. And you know, you're going to ask him a lot more questions, but at the end of this interview, you're going to go and pick up your guitar and pick up that paintbrush that you left behind in order to become an engineer or whatever specialty that you followed.
Absolutely.
But it was so beautiful what you said, and we're continuing this discussion.
Yes.
So Ashish, another interesting bit that I picked up from your book was when you said that there was an Oxford study which predicted that by 2034, most mid-level jobs would actually get replaced by machines.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking that, you know, the students watching the show, perhaps by 2034 would be in those mid-level jobs.
Yeah.
Now, what is it that you can say to them right now that they should be doing, or what advice would you give them to make sure that at the time when that happens, they still have their jobs and they still are part of this long, successful career?
It's too much of an ask to kind of expect current learner to think about that what's going to happen in 2034,
right,
when experts are struggling. One of the things which I think is a student on a general level is the difference between content and container.
Mm-hmm.
Whether we are perfecting our container or whether we are learning and mugging the content in any field. When I say perfecting the container, it's about the ability of your mind.
Mm.
If you perfect your container, then handling the content will be easier. And that you gain by, again, I would say that reading books which take you deeper into a thought.
Mm.
Philosophical readings, literature, understanding your own self, your abilities. So that's one aspect of how you can prepare for machines.
Mm.
And it is a bit challenging. The other aspect which I feel is the multidimensionality of the intelligence. How further you are from that machine in terms of your intelligence will save you. So remaining fresh, original, and always kind of understanding the unknown. And you know, when we are caught in that rat race of education and we have to clear that exam and we have to clear that entrance or get into that university, we somehow tend to neglect that ability, that skill set, that, you know, we need to perfect our container. We focus too much on the content, and then the content is then brought down to the level of formulas, and then there are keys to do, and then objective types, and then, you know, you just focus on clearing that one particular question.
Absolutely beautiful, because, and as you rightly said, unfortunately they're so sort of taken in with this pressure of that situation that they're in. The system makes them a certain way, and we have a very narrow bottleneck in higher education in India. So unwittingly we've got to all sort of conform and in order to go through. But still having this at the back of your mind and recognizing that whilst I'm doing this, I'm still continuing to be a wholesome learner. And imbibing critical thinking to emotional intelligence, to maybe a spiritual intelligence, to maybe analytical and all of that together. it's a tall ask for young students.
It's a
great thing to have in your mind.
No, I think that absolutely it's a tall ask that, you know, they have their own journey and there is a lot of pressure from the parents and the system and the peers. And you somehow tend to feel that, you know, if I'm not on this journey, if I somehow sort of do take a detour or sort of fall in one, then there is nothing left in the world.
Right.
I'm the failure, I'm not successful, and I will lag behind. You have to be a constant learner. That's something which I feel is given.
So Ashish, before we cap this show,
yeah.
is there some top pieces of advice that you would want to share with them? That if right now they're experiencing a moment of failure, what is it that we can tell them about what their future is going to be and how they can remain motivated for that?
Every great mind, every important thing has happened because of a failure. So if I fail today and if I'm feeling that my world is shattered, I need to understand that this is absolutely not the end of the world. You know why people actually fear failure? Because it is about that I don't have time. Just imagine if we were like 400 year of lifespan, would we bother if we failed at 17? We would just say that I have 100 more years to kind of do my degree. And a recent study came which suggested that the average age of a successful startup founder is 42.5. which is not 17 or 19 or 24 or 35, which is
contrary 40. To what we would
absolutely.
Have thought.
That is one momentary thing that, you know, it's absolutely fine as long as you have given your best, as long as you can. And there is always second chance in life, there's always third chance in life, there's always fourth chance in life. We need to kind of have this visual in our mind all the time, which is that imagine that life is like a highway, and incidentally you are in a lane where there is no one. So it is not a rat race. You are in a lane competing with yourself. There's no one in front of you, there's no one behind you. My only work is to better myself.
That is so liberating for the student. But I wish the parents are listening as well, and they don't ask their child when he comes home with a grade card that, you know, who got more marks than you and what did so and so get. So also very interesting thing that you said in the beginning of this last bit was that people have succeeded because of their failure. You know, you didn't, I noticed you didn't say that they've succeeded despite the failure. You said they've succeeded because of the failure. So on that happy note that the failure will actually lead in linearly to success. I'd like to thank you for being with us and
thank
for
you so much.
Sharing all this beautiful wisdom.
Thank you.
And good luck to you for the future, many more books and a lot of more success.
Thank you. Thanks a lot,
Jay. Hey, and thank you for watching right till the end. I'm sure a lot of this was motivating to you. And if you've ever failed in your lives, you know you can make a huge success today and going forward. So if you have any other questions that you'd like to ask me or Ashish, put everything down in the comment section, like the video, share it with your friends and subscribe to the channel. And don't forget that bell icon that'll give you all your notifications. And happy watching!